Hello. This is Alternate Aurora. And tonight, I'm going to be telling you some stories. Some scary stories. From a book called Scary Stories 3. More tales to chill your bones. This is a book of folklore collected by Alvin Schwartz. This is the third installment of his Scary Stories series. We will first read the introduction, titled Boo-Man. The girl was late getting home for supper, so she took a shortcut through the cemetery, but oh, it made her nervous. When she saw another girl ahead of her, she hurried to catch up. "Do you mind if I walk with you?" she asked. "Walking through the cemetery at night scares me." "I know what you mean," the other girl said. "I used to feel that way myself when I was alive." There are all sorts of things that scare. The dead scare us, for one day we will be dead like they are. The dark scares us, for we don't know what is waiting in the dark. At night, the sound of leaves rustling, or branches growing, or someone whispering makes us uneasy. So do footsteps coming closer. So do strange figures we think we see in the shadows. A human, maybe, or a big animal, or some horrible thing we can barely make out. People call these creatures we think we see boo-men. We imagine them, they say. But now and then, a boo-man turns out to be real. Queer happenings scare us, too. We hear of a boy or a girl who was raised by an animal. A human being like us, who yelps and howls and runs on all fours. The thought of it makes our flesh crawl. We hear of insects that make their nests in a person's body, or of a nightmare that comes true, and we shudder. If such things really do happen, and make it happen to us. It is from such fears that scary stories grow. This is the third book of such stories I have collected. I learned some of them from people I met. I found others, tales that had been written down in folklore archives and in libraries. As we always do with tales we learn, I have told them in my own way. Some stories in this book have been told only in recent times, but others have been part of our folklore for as long as we know. As one person told another, the details may have changed, but the story itself has not. For what once frightened people still frightens them. I thought at first that one of the stories I found was a modern story. It is the one I call The Bus Stop. I then discovered that a similar story had been told 2,000 years earlier in ancient Rome, that the young woman involved was named Philia, not Joanna, as she is in our story. Are the stories in this book true? The one I call The Trouble is true. I can't be sure about the others. Most may have at least a little truth, for strange things sometimes happen, and people love to tell about them and turn them into even better stories. Nowadays, most people say that they don't believe in ghosts and queer happenings and such, yet they still fear the dead and the dark. And they still see blue men waiting in the shadows. And they still tell scary stories, just as people always have. Alvin Schwartz. The first section of the book is called When Death Arrives. When death arrives, it is usually the end of the story. But in these stories, it is only the beginning. The appointment. A 16-year-old boy worked on his grandfather's horse farm. One morning, he drove a pickup truck into town on an errand. While he was walking along the main street, he saw death. Death beckoned to him. The boy drove back to the farm as fast as he could and told his grandfather what had happened. "Give me the truck," he begged. "I'll go into the city. You'll never find me there." His grandfather gave him the truck, and the boy sped away. After he left, his grandfather went into town looking for death. When he found him, he asked, "Why did you frighten my grandson that way? He is only 16. He is too young to die." I am sorry about that, said Death. I did not mean to beckon him, but I was surprised to see him here. You see, I have an appointment with him this afternoon in the city. The bus stop. Ed Cox was driving home from work in a rainstorm. While he waited for traffic light to change, he saw a young woman standing alone at a bus stop. She had no umbrella and was soaking wet. Are you going toward Farmingtown? He called. Yes, I am, she said. Would you like a ride? I would, she said, and got in. My name is Joanna Finney. Thank you for rescuing me. I'm Ed Cox, he said, and you're welcome. On the way, they talked and talked. She told him about her family and her job, and where she had gone to school. And he told her about himself. By the time they got to her house, the rain had stopped. I'm glad it rained, Ed said. Would you like to go out tomorrow after work? I'd love to, Joanna said. She asked him to meet her at the bus stop, since it was near her office. They had such a good time, they went out many times after that. Always they would meet at the bus stop, and off they would go. Ed liked her more and more each time he saw her. But one night, when they had a date to go out, Joanna did not appear. Ed waited at the bus stop for almost an hour. Maybe something is wrong, he thought. And he drove to her house in Farmingtown. An older woman came to the door. I'm Ed Cox, he said. Maybe Joanna told you about me. I had a date with her tonight. We were supposed to meet up at the bus stop near her office. But she didn't show up. Is she all right? The woman looked at him as if he had said something very strange. I am Joanna's mother, she said slowly. Joanna isn't here right now. But why don't you come in? Ed pointed to a picture on the mantel. That looks just like her. Did once, her mother replied. But that picture was taken when she was your age, about 20 years ago. A few days later, she was waiting in the rain at that bus stop. A car hit her, and she was killed. Faster and faster. Sam and his cousin Bob went walking through the woods. The only sounds were leaves rustling, and now and again a bird chirping. It's so quiet here, Bob whispered. But that soon changed. After a few minutes, the two boys started whooping and hollering and chasing one another around. Sam ducked behind a tree. When Bob came by, Sam jumped out at him. Then Bob raced ahead and hid behind a bush. When he looked down, there at his feet was an old drum. Sam, See what I found, he called. It looks like a tom-tom. I bet it's 100 years old. Look at the red stains on it, said Sam. I bet it's somebody's blood. Let's get out of here. But Bob could not resist trying the drum. He sat on the ground and held it between his legs. He beat on it with one hand, and then the other, slowly at first, then faster and faster, almost as if he could not stop. Suddenly, there were shouts in the woods, and the sound of hoofbeats. A cloud of dust rose from behind a line of trees. Then men on horseback galloped toward them. Bob, let's go, Sam shouted. He began to run. Hurry! Bob dropped the drum and ran after him. Sam heard the twang of a bow firing an arrow. Then he heard Bob scream. When Sam turned around, he saw Bob, pitch forward, dead. But there was no arrow in his body, and there was no wound. And when the police searched, there were no men on horseback, and there were no hoof prints, and there was no drum. The only sounds were leaves rustling, and now and again, a bird chirping. Just delicious. George Flint loved to eat. Each day at noon, he closed his camera shop. For 2 hours, and went home for a big lunch his wife Mina cooked for him. George was a bully, and Mina a timid woman, who did everything he asked because she was afraid of him. On his way home for lunch one day, George stopped at the butcher shop and bought a pound of liver. He loved liver. He would have Mina cook it for him for dinner that night. Despite all his complaints about her, she was a very While George ate his lunch, Mina told him that a rich old woman in town had died. Her body was in the church next door. It was an open coffin. Anyone who wanted to see her could. As usual, George was not interested in what Mina had to say. I've got to go back to work, he told her. After he left, Mina began to cook the liver. She added vegetables and spices and simmered it all afternoon, just the way George liked it. When she thought it was done, she cut off a small piece and tasted it. It was delicious, the best she had ever made. She ate a second piece, then a third. It was so good, she could not stop eating it. It was only when the liver was all gone that she thought of George. He would be coming home soon. What would he do when he found that she had eaten all of the liver? Some men would laugh, but not George. He would be angry and mean, and she did not want to face that again. But where could she get another piece of liver that late in the day? Then she remembered the old woman, lying in the church next door, waiting to be buried. George George said he had never had a better dinner. "Have some liver, Mina," he said. "It's just delicious." "I'm not hungry," she said. "You finish it." That night, after George had fallen asleep, Mina sat in bed trying to read. But all she could think about was what she had done. Then she thought she heard a woman's voice. "Who has my liver?" it asked. "Who has it?" Was it her imagination? Was she dreaming? Now the voice was closer. "Who has my liver?" it asked. "Who has it? Who has my liver?" it asked. "Who has it?" Mina wanted to run. "No. No," she whispered. "I don't have it. I don't have your liver." Now the voice was right next to her. "Who has my liver? Who has it?" Mina froze with terror. She pointed to George. "He does," she said. "He has it." Suddenly, the light went out, and George screamed. And screamed. Hello, Kate. Tom Connors was on his way to a dance in the next village. It was a long walk through the fields and the woods, but it was a soft, sweet evening, and he loved dancing, so Tom didn't mind. He had gone only a short distance when he noticed a young woman following him. "Maybe she is going to the dance," he thought, and he stopped and waited for her. As the woman got closer, he saw that it was Kate Vardy. They had danced together many times. He was about to call, "Hello, Kate," when suddenly he remembered that Kate was dead. She had died last year, yet there she was, all dressed up for the dance. Tom wanted to run, but somehow it didn't seem right to run from Kate. He turned and started to walk away as fast as he could. But Kate followed him. He took a shortcut across a field, but still she followed. When he got to the dance hall, she was right behind him. There were a lot of people standing outside, and Tom tried to lose Kate in the crowd. He worked his way to the side of the building and squeezed up against the wall behind some people, but Kate followed. She came so close that she brushed up against. Then she stopped and waited. He wanted to say, "Hello, Kate," just as the way he did when she was alive. But he was so frightened he couldn't speak. Her eyes looked into his eyes, and then she vanished. The black dog. It was 11 o'clock at night. Peter Rothberg was in bed on the second floor of the old house, where he lived alone. It had gotten so chilly. He went downstairs to turn up the heat. As Peter was on his way back to bed, a black dog ran down the stairs. It passed him and disappeared into the darkness. "Where did you come from?" Peter asked. He had never seen that dog before. He turned on all the lights and looked in every room. He could not find the dog anywhere. He went outside and brought in two watchdogs he kept in the backyard, but they acted as if they were only the dog. But they acted as if they were the only dogs in the house. The next night, again, at 11 o'clock, Peter was in his bedroom and heard what sounded like a dog walking around his room. He heard what sounded like a dog walking around in the room above him. He dashed upstairs and threw open the door. The room was empty. He looked under the bed. He looked in the closet. Nothing. But when he got back to his bedroom, he heard a dog running down the stairs. It was a black dog. He tried to follow it, but again, he could not find where it had gone. From then on, every night at 11, Peter heard the dog walking in the room above him. The room was always empty, but after he left, the dog would come out of hiding, run down the stairs, and disappear. One night, Peter's neighbor waited with him for the dog. At the usual time, they heard it above them. Then, they heard it on the stairs. When they went out into the hall, it was standing at the foot of the stairs, looking up at them. The neighbor whistled. The dog wagged its tail, and then it was gone. Things went on this way until the night Peter decided to bring his watchdogs into the house again. Maybe this time they would find the black dog and drive it away. Just before 11, he took them up to his bedroom and left the door open. Then he heard the black dog moving around above him. His dogs pricked up their ears and ran to the door. Suddenly, they bared their teeth and snarled and backed away. Peter could not see the black dog or hear it, but he was sure it had entered his room. His dogs barked and snapped. They darted forward nervously, then backed away again. Suddenly, one of them yelped. It began bleeding and dropped to the floor. Its neck torn open. A minute later, it was dead. Peter's other dog backed into a corner, whimpering. Then everything was still. The next night, Peter's neighbor came back with a pistol. Again, they waited in his bedroom. At 11 o'clock, the black dog came down the stairs. As before, it looked up at them and wagged its tail. When they started toward it with the pistol, it growled and disappeared. That was the last Peter saw of the black dog. But it did not mean that the dog was gone. Now and then, always at 11, he heard it moving around above him. Once he heard it running down the stairs. He never managed to see it again, but he knew that it was there. Footsteps. Liz was doing her homework at the dining room table. Her younger sister, Sarah, was asleep upstairs. Their mother was out, but she was expected back at any minute. When the front door opened and shut, Liz called, "Hello, Mama," but her mother didn't answer. And the footsteps Liz heard were heavier, like a man's. "Who's there?" she called. No one replied. She heard whoever it was walk through the living room, then up the stairs to the second floor. The footsteps moved from one bedroom to another. Again, Liz called. "Who's there?" Footsteps stopped. And then she thought, "Oh my God, Sarah is in her bedroom." She ran upstairs to Sarah's room. Only Sarah was there. She was asleep. Liz looked into the other rooms, but found no one. She went back down to the dining room, scared out of her wits. Soon, she heard the footsteps again. They were coming down the stairs, into the living room. Now they went into the kitchen, and the door between the kitchen and the dining room slowly began to open. "Get out," Liz screamed. The door slowly closed. The footsteps moved out of the kitchen, through the living room, toward the front door. The door opened and shut. Liz ran to the window to see who it was. No one was in sight, nor were there any footprints in the fresh snow that had been falling. Like cat's eyes. As Jim Brand lay dying, his wife left him with his nurse and went into the next room to rest. She sat in the dark, staring into the night. Suddenly, Mrs. Brand saw headlights come rapidly up the driveway. "Oh no," she thought. "I don't want visitors now. Not now." But it wasn't a car bringing a visitor. It was an old hearse with maybe half a dozen small men hanging from the sides. At least, that's what it looked like. The hearse screeched to a stop. The men jumped off and stared up at her, their eyes glowing with a soft yellow light like cat's eyes. She watched with horror as they disappeared into the house. An instant later, they were back, lifting something into the hearse. Then they drove off in high speed, wheels squealing, the gravel and the driveway flying in all directions. At that moment, the nurse came in to say that Jim Brand had died. And that concludes the first section of stories in Scary Stories 3. More tales to chill your bones.